The Ministry of Secondary Education has developed a distance learning platform for students of secondary education in Cameroon. A series of lessons taught by qualified teachers for secondary school students. Under the stewardship of Professor Pauline Nalovalyonga, in collaboration with the Ministry of Posts and Telecommunications, CAMTEL, CRTV, and UNESCO, we are introducing distance learning as another teaching and learning method which is different from the traditional classroom setting that you are all used to. In the distance education mode, you are not with the teacher in person, so take your time, relax, listen to the teacher, take down notes and visit the following links for any questions or answers to your questions. Take it in your stride. This is Cameroon's solution to COVID-19 and beyond. Professor Nalovalyonga, Minister of Secondary Education.
Welcome to lesson 48 of your distance learning session for Geology of Basic Science with Kenneth Yosimbo. During our lesson 47, we had some assignment, and the assignment required that we should draw and label the following morphological variations found in Rogo's aura and give an example of each. They include dendroid corallum, fascinoid corallum. If we carefully look at the question, there are two aspects. You have draw and label. And remember that in paleontology, labels must be diagnostic. That is why when we say draw annotated diagrams, it's not like you draw and give the meaning of a part, but involve those parts that will be able to diagnose what the phylum is, which class it is, and the different modes of life. So, in our diagram, there is one particular part, that is the calyx, that is common for dendroid, fascinoid, and cylindrical. Remember that you were required to draw for dendroid and fascinoid corallium. So the morphological part there that is diagnostic is the calyx. Now, for dendroid corallium, the further fasciculate corallium is the identical feature, or is the diagnostic feature. Then for fascinoid corallium, the fact that there is irregular branching corallite and that the corallite is more or less parallel is diagnostic. That is, those are the key aspects that are necessary to answer the question for the assignment. Remember that diagrammatic representations are very, very essential. Now, we still continue with paleontology. And under paleontology, we've seen the scope of paleontology, the types of fossils, conditions necessary for fossilization, modes of fossilization, occurrence and uses of fossils, gaps in fossil records, as well as fossil assemblages, classification of fossils. These aspects that have been seen before helps us to be able to classify fossils. So our topic of discussion is centered on description of fossils. Our lesson 48, therefore, is titled Description of Fossils 15. We still concentrate on Phylum Coelenterata. We shall treat the other tabulata and Sperratina. This will mark the end of description as well as our topic of discussion. Now, in our lesson overview, look at the objectives of our lesson. Look at the prerequisites, that is essential and vital information that is required for us to better appropriate real life situation. Look at hypotheses as well as the lesson activity or the learning activity. Then we'll have to recall, remember that in this lesson that is ending the chapter in paleontology. We are going to replay the whole structure that we have seen. Then we will have some exercises and we shall end our lesson with an assignment. At the end of this lesson, we shall be able to describe and identify fossil genera under phylum Coelenterata, especially for the order Tabulata and Sclerotina. This will be based on the shell form. As information that is essential and vital for understanding of these two particular order in the phylum Coelenterata, we will have to recall information on geological basis for classifying fossils. Remember that we underline the fact that we need morphological features and ecological aspects that can help us to place fossils under a particular phylum, under a particular class, under a particular order, and then be able to establish the mode of life of the organism when it was still in the life form. This basis therefore helped us to group fossils under six common phyla, the last one which we are treating today. This is information that is very essential. Now, a petroleum engineer visits the Bakassi Peninsula in southwest Cameroon. He collected samples of the rocks in different locations and noted many types of fossil shells and fossil traces that differ greatly. Now, our worry is, what revealed the differences between the fossils? That is, the fossil traces and the fossil remains. Looking at the hypothesis, is it that he used the effect of the rotational agents on the fossils, that is, the effect of running water action, wave action, wind action, gravity action, or ice action? Would that have been the way to reveal, or what revealed the differences? About the idea of gaps in fossil records, would that have been what revealed the differences? Or the element of morphological and ecological aspects of the fossils? As we go through our lesson, we shall look at which of the hypotheses would have helped our petroleum engineer to be able to come out with those differences in the fossil shells as well as the fossil traces. Now, lesson activity, shall observe again these photos of fossil shells and you will deduce the visible features. Look at fossil A right up to fossil F. While you observe, you should be able to bring out external features that are diagnostic in all the fossil photos as well as the shear drawing. So look at A, you will realize some peculiarities. A, C, and E have some peculiarities. And then B, D, and F also have some peculiarities. So practically, those diagnostic features will include the tube, that is the corallite. Then we have vertical radial partition, that is common wave for cell B, T, and F. That is called the septa. Then we have the upper end skeleton, which is common wave for cell A, C, and D. That is a cup-shaped structure, which is called the calyx. This guides us to continue with the two other under class anthozoa, commonly referred to as corals. So we are in the second order, Scleractina. Under the other Scleractina, if you look at this photo of the shell form, you realize that the coral constitutes contains so many of this corallites. Once they are mini, we describe them as compound. So you can also refer to other Scleractina as compound corals. Now the shell form of Scleractina corals is calcareous, meaning that they contain calcium carbonate. They are both compound or solid. And the septa is arranged in a multiple of six. That gives it the name hexacorala. The skeleton of solitary form is conical or cylindrical. Then they have wide compound forms, and the basal plate is the first form part of the shell, which means that the rounded structures that we saw in our photo should form the basal plate. They also have a septa and dissipament. Remember that dissipaments are cross bars that help to bring stability in the shell form. They have varying columella and they lack axial structures. The common examples of the fossil under the order Scleractina include the Cosumilla, and we also have the Goniopora. These forms are most likely marine. Not only marine, but they are shallow, meaning that they thrive both at the littoral and the neritic zones where they are preserved. And they range of they range mostly in Triassic formations. These are the common shell forms. We have the Balanophilia, that is the calyx presentation. Then you have the Goniopora. Then we have the Tecosmilia. Those are the common fossil shells or fossil forms under Scleractina corals. Note should be taken that these drawings are in the study position. So each time you want to draw, you must follow this order of drawing. The geological history of Scleractina corals. They first appeared in the Middle Triassic, and then they increased in Jurassic and remain till today. Now, the other tabulata, also referred to as tabulate corals. The tabulate corals have some peculiarities. You look at this structure, there is a greeny portion that is called the tabula, and then the red portion that forms the corallite. Then the whole structure of these depressions or holes form the corallium. That is the general photo of the fossil or fossils under other tabulata or tabulate corax. Then the shell form of tabulate corax. Here they are exclusively colonial calcareous skeleton fossils, and they have poorly developed or no septa at all. The tabula form other elements of the shell. That is why they adopt the name tabulate corax. The corallite are united by connected tubes. These connected tubes form the corallum. The corallite unite laterally, forming a series of meandering walls. These meandering walls could be impressions of the corallite. Then they have communicating holes, and these communicating holes are called mural walls. The corallite are separated from each other by a conchyle. Take note again. The corallites are separated from each other by conchyle. Here, you should be able to make a difference between the conchyle and the mural walls. The common examples here include the syringora, and then we also have the halicides. Those are the most common fossilized tabulate corals. Then they range from Cambrian to Permian. Then the shell form of tabulate corals. In their shell form, you have this is the shell form of favocytes. Then the shell form of halicides. Then you have also the shell form of heliolites. Then this is the shell form of syringopora. And then we have the lerodictyum. Now remember that the characteristics that we are just from seeing are common for all tabulate corals. Geological history of tabulate corals. The tabulate corals first appeared in Middle Ordovician. Take note that they became abundant in Silurian and Devonian. And then they decreased or they declined in the Paleozoic and became extinct at the end of the Paleozoic. So geologically, these fossils are most likely Ordovician. The geological importance of corals. After having looked at rugose, sclerotina, as well as the tabulate corals, what are the geological significance or the paleontological significance? They are important as paleo-environmental indicators. Remember that in our treatment of the lesson under uses of fossils, we said fossils could be used as paleoclimatic indicators. And specifically, we use corals as an example. The fact that the environments where they form were mostly in the tropics. So, corals will indicate shallow marine environments, meaning they thrive mostly in littoral and neritic zones or otic zones. They are used therefore as zone fossils. Remember that zone fossils are those particular fossil species that are characterized or that characterize a particular geologic formation, but they are restricted with time. Then, the Filu are the little stone shoes are used for correlating rocks. Note should be taken that this particular fossil group, especially the corals, play a vital role in stratigraphy and to geologists, especially in correlation. Now recall that Theratina corals are compact or solid. They have septa arranged in a multiple of six. That is why they are generally called hexacorala. Then they include Thecosmelia and Goniophora. They are mostly shallow marine and they range from Triassic to present. Now, generally, we are having our lesson on paleontology. So note should be taken that in paleontology, fossils in general are most, the term fossil is derived from the Greek word fossil, which means dug up from the ground. And that there are different varieties or types of fossils. There are also different modes in which fossils are preserved. And that fossils are generally classified based on their morphological and ecological aspects, and that their evolution involve both the ecological aspects as well as the geologic condition. Now, tabulate corals are exclusively colonial and they have fully developed or absent septa. They have corallites united by connected tubes and they include Syringophora, Syringora, and the halicides. They again include Syringora, and then we have the halicides. This group range from Cambrian to Permian. So generally, they end our lesson in paleontology, especially with description of fossils. Now we shall get into some exercises. These exercises will be specific for our lesson of today. Now, exercise number one targets our real life situation that we evoked at the beginning of the lesson. Now, at the beginning of the lesson, we're asking a question. What revealed the differences between the fossils observed by the petroleum engineer in the Bakassi Peninsula? A. The effect of denudational agents on the fossils. B. The idea of gaps in fossil records. C. Morphological and ecological aspects of the fossil. Our correct answer is C. Meaning that in order for the petroleum engineer to have made the difference between the fossil shells and the fossil traces, he ought to concentrate on the shell form and then develop those, give attention to those features as he moved collecting the shells from one locality to the other. This generally helps us to know that in treating fossils in paleontology, the whole attention is given to morphological and ecological aspects. This therefore will guide the classification of fossils into the different phyla. We have seen six of them. We have the phylum Mollusca, the phylum Brachiopoda, the phylum Echinodermata, the phylum Arthropoda, phylum Coelenterata, which ends the last part of description of fossils. Now study the fossil drawings below and answer the questions that follow. The fossil drawing involves fossil F, G, H, I, J, and K. So you observe them critically and you answer the following question. Which of the fossils above contain a basal plate? This is still the photo beside. So if you observe critically, which of them contain the basal plate? Correct answer is A. That is, fossil F, G, and H contain the basal plate. And next, still on those diagrams, which of them have a columella but lack an axial or lack axial structures? We have A, F and G, B, G and H, C, H and K, D, I and J. You observe these are differential forms that are represented. Our correct answer is B. So B, G and H, that is G and H, they have a columella, but they lack an axial, they lack axial structures. Identify the fossil form with corallite united laterally, but forming a series of meandering walls. You still observe from F, G, H, I, J, and K. Now, correct answer is J. This is J. It contains corallite. And then the corallites, you can realize that they are united and they have meandering walls. These are the meandering walls. Question 5. Identify the fossil genera level G, H, I, J, and K. This is G, H, I, J, and K. So, G is the Corsmilia. Then H is the Goniophora. Then I is Favocyte. Then J is Halicyte. Then K is Heliolite. Question 6. Give the age range of fossil group I, J, and K. This is I, J, and K. A, Cambrian to Permian, B, Triassic to Recent, C, Lower Carboniferous, D, from Tertiary. Correct answer is A, from Cambrian to Permian. Now, as take-home assignment. 1. Why are robots, Steractina, and tabulate corals under the same finding? 2. State two similarities and two differences between robots, Steractina, and tabulate corals. This ends our lesson under the topic paleontology. You can always read Geology for Advanced Level, The Fundamentals of Geology, and Principles of Geology for further information. And you can always visit the site in order to pose questions that are difficult as you follow up the lessons. So we have come to the end of our lesson and the topic paleontology. Our next topic will be on map work and photo interpretation. See you in our next class. Unatege si matege yob, unatege minga matege nyom.
Uno tege majang makagendom Mane tambia ninya ne injubyayen Ngani bana matege mot Ngani lakiri watagendom Esa kina bia dinkido Mane tambia ninya ne injubyayen Tam tama mote tam zabike Tam tama tonge tam zabike Tam tam tama mote tam zabike Mane tambia ninya ne injubyayen